Hello, magniloquently MM Ms. Masses. An eccentric mock mention, mock mates, but it is a mock mention, and it's been mentioned, and thank you to Dr. Ganglia for the mock mention provision. Ideal for our purposes, and our purpose is to review this fine single malt whiskey here in the Manx Bothy in the middle of the Irish Sea. It's 12-year-old Glen Grant. It's a single malt Scotch whiskey. Och aye, hoots toots the new. And it's been bottled aged 12 years at 43% volume. And in case you haven't seen this particular version of Glen Grant before, it's no surprise. It was only introduced to the global market in the last 12 months. Prior to that, our options for Glen Grant were fairly restricted. You had the Major's Reserve and you had a 10-year-old. 10-year-old is kind of decent. Major's Reserve, non-age statement, not my cup of tea, no review for that. However, the 12-year-old, two more useful years in terms of maturation in a single malt, which particularly benefits from time in the cask. I'm going to come back to that shortly. This is a good whisky to review because for non-whisky drinkers, this smells and tastes like what people believe whisky should smell and taste like. I'll explain that in a minute. I'm going to nose this, I'm going to taste it, I'm going to malt mark it, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about Glen Grant, the options out there, what sort of cost it is, and why you should buy it. Simple as that. I have a number of Glen Grants in my little stash, my whiskey stash, which I bought a number of years ago, mainly from independent bottlers, for the simple reason that Glen Grant, amongst independent bottlers, has always had a pretty good reputation for comprehensive, old-school maturation, where you really taste the age that's coming out of the bottle. And this is increasingly either a rare thing to find or an increasingly expensive thing to be able to buy, particularly from official bottlers. So I'm going to touch on some of the terms of cost per year in the cask, from what you can actually buy, not at auction, but at retail shops. Glen Grant is actually a hard one to beat. But let's tackle this review, first of all. Get me spoon, water, glass of whiskey, and now let's nose. Now, make sure you've got no distractions out there. Don't answer the telephone. Don't bother with the television. If anybody needs you, they can need you later. This is your time, your malt moment. Cherish it, malt mates. Malty. Grain, malty, toffee, barley sugar. A little bit of graininess. Very much a Speyside character. Slightly sweet in the nose. Spicy in there. Not a lot of herbal. Very little salt. Very little sour, really. Tannins more than sour. But a slightly solventy, but rounded, relatively young, single malt nose. Are you getting much more for your extra 2 years over and above the 10-year-old? Yes, you are. I'm immediately noticing at the tail end of smelling this whiskey that you're getting those lovely little aromatic fruity notes that you get, a little bit of green apple, a little bit of banana. To taste, I know I've just added water, so I've jumped the gun a bit here. I should have tasted it first. And what I'd be telling you is this, that it's got a lovely arrival. It's really quite sweet, intense and malty. It tastes just like what people who don't drink whiskey think whiskey should taste like. Sweet, definitely. Sour does come in not that far afterwards. We're not long in. So sweet arrival, then sour. So sweet and sour in the first 5 seconds. Slightly aromatic. You're getting quite a complex array of spice, allspice, nutmeg and cardamom there. A little bit of orange peel going on in the background. And then you're getting these lovely little delicate soft citrus and light fruity notes. Banana, guava, a little bit of green apple and pear. The finish is quite tannin rich. It's a little bit dry. You're seeing that even at 12 years, the effects of the casks have been to introduce right from the beginning a certain astringency into the development finish of this single malt. However, I have added water. I'm going to add a drop more, but watch you don't add too much. But I can tell you from my experience, I know I've not actually taken much out of the bottle because I've been busy reviewing some rums actually. So I've not had much volume of this single malt prior to in my preparation for this review. However, I've had enough to discover quite dramatically how putting a little bit of water in the glass, if you're having it as a neat single malt, and you're not putting ice cubes in, and you're not putting Coca-Cola and soda water in, which many people who drink this do. I don't. It's just not my style. But if you give it, as they say, a minute in the glass for each year in the cask, what you will find is that tannin-heavy astringency starts to mellow out. Now, I'm not saying, malt mates, that this whiskey becomes sweeter. Many single malts can take on a certain sweetness and start to take on a little bit more proactive cask influence in the delivery of the arrival, development, and finish in the taste. However, this one, it's not working quite like that. It's a little bit eccentric, it's a little bit singular. What's happening is not so much a sweetness developing, but actually a tannic, slight dampening sour note that follows on from the sweet and sour arrival. It's kind of simply dissolving slightly and revealing some of the delicious, characterful spirit complexity that is coming through from the Glen Grant stills. And in that respect, it's working really, really well. It would, without doubt, have been better at 46% unchilled filtered. But hey, I know I sound like a burst old gramophone when I'm saying that, but I'm saying it because I mean it, because it matters. You understand that, malt mates. You know it's part of the deal. If there's one distillery out there which undersells itself 24/7, it's Glen Grant. It really is. But first a malt mark. Nice little slight earthy note coming through there. Casks, not quite sure. It's a mixture of refill ex-bourbony casks. The casks are sort of vague, as if they've been over-prepared and over-processed in their production and assembly for use, and I find that a little bit disconcerting. It's making me actually look at some of these old Glen Grants that you can buy from Gordon and MacPhail, Berry Brothers and Rudd, and Signatory too. It makes me look at those bottlings in a very fresh light that I didn't used to even a few years ago. It's coming through now. More fresh fruit, fresh malt, delicious, sweet, clear barley sugar note, slightly astringent, and more citrus creeping in. As if the tannins, with the benefit of a little bit of water, not a lot of water, just a little bit, are really settling down and being replaced systematically by some delicious, fresh, sweet and sour lemon and lime and grapefruit and green pear, and a lot going on here. A delicious, standard, available and affordable single malt whisky, which I, Ralphie, am happy to recommend. particularly if you're on a budget and you're relatively inexperienced. You're going to get a lot from this. Malt mark. Where's my malt mark cards? I'm sure I've got a card in here for the occasion. Here we go. Nah, actually, I'll do one more than that. 86 out of 100. Really, this would be up in the 90s if this was a craft presentation. But it isn't. It's still a kind of old school standard blended branded bottling. If they were to do a single cask 12-year-old Glen Grant at cask strength, I would certainly be very interested in that. But in the moment, MALT malt mark, 86 of 100. It's not a spectacular mark. It's not going to blow your socks off, but malt mates, for the price, the availability, this is a good, decent, flavoursome single malt, which does what single malts are supposed to do and give you a single malt experience that doesn't taste of something else. You see, that's the punchline. There we go. There's no double maturation going on here. There's no hokey cokey casks. Can I say that? Glen Grant is one of Scotland's older distilleries. It's also one of Scotland's largest single malt distilleries. Founded back around about the 1840s, it has been passed around from owner to owner like aces in a game of poker. Not that I've played poker, and probably making a statement like that, it shows, but I'll swiftly move on. Ten years ago, Glen Grant was really kind of off the radar. It was well known that in Southern Europe, young Glen Grants were very popular amongst younger whisky drinkers. But it tends to be very much overlooked in the UK, in the British Isles, in favour of the two larger distilleries, Glenfiddich and Macallan. However, Glen Grant is a big producing distillery, slightly larger than Glenlivet. And in doing so, you have this tremendous volume of production over time, which means that casks are being sold on a fairly regular basis over time to independent bottlers who frankly have valued the brand far more respectfully than the official owners of the distillery. Sure, it goes into a lot of blends out there. That's what Glen Grant does. But if you look at your shops, at your online shops, even in the auctions, wherever, you will find that particularly Gordon and MacPhail feature some seriously old bottlings of Glen Grant, which are nothing short of spectacular. Same with Signatory, same with Berry Brothers and Rudd. In fact, I've featured Glen Grants at some of my extremely rare and few and far between whisky tastings in Glasgow, which don't happen very often. It's a really impressive whisky with age. Not only that, but it's been one cask maturation, generally speaking. And as such, when you're tasting a whisky that's been 40 years old, 50 year old Glen Grant, the chances are it's been in the same cask for those 40 to 50 years. Now, that's important. It really is, because it means that the actual cask was first used decades ago, and it was simply a different generation of cask, a different calibre of cask, a different density of wood, a different calibre of wood. It was air-dry conditioned. It was made to last a lifetime. And that's why these whiskies could mature a lifetime, because the casks could deliver that, basically could deliver the job. Where else, and which other brand are you going to find? Glenfarclas until recently, but their prices are jumping up for their old sherried whiskies. But Glen Grant sherried whiskies, they're, you know, the old ones, they're gemstones, malt mates. They are gemstones. And where else, in which other brand would you find a 50-year-old single malt for less than £1,000? You won't. With Glen Grant, you have a very rare opportunity should you decide you want to buy a particularly old time-travelled single malt as an anniversary, birthday, Christmas, New Year's gift. Of course, the best gifts that we buy, sorry, I'll start that again. The best gifts that we get are the ones we buy for ourselves. So I actually have a couple of bottles already in the Ralphie stash for these special occasions, and I'm sure at some point I will share one with you, and I will probably get dewy-eyed and sentimental about the good old days, which weren't that good actually. However, there's nothing like wallowing in nostalgia to make us feel good. What else about Glen Grant? Availability of official bottlings, there's not a lot to choose from. I mean, this surprises me. It really does, particularly at this moment in time. You've got the non-age statement, 10-year, 12-year old, and basically that's about it. I mean, it depends really what's available at any point in time. I mean, I've been looking at a couple of shops online recently, and this is about it. It's the independent bottlings which are featuring far more prominently and frankly deservedly so. I think that's about me. I think I'm done and dusted. Glen Grant, go find malt mates. I would say in all seriousness, there's no such thing as a bad bottling of Glen Grant out there. There's some which are simply less developed than others. And I would conclude by saying that Glen Grant, and I've mentioned this before, but some things are just worth repeating, malt mates, just as a reminder, that Glen Grant is like Mortlach, like Macallan, like Springbank, like Glenlivet. It just has that intrinsic ability through the signature of the new-made spirit to successfully continue to age in casks without taking on too much of the negative attributes of old casks. In other words, they don't get swamped and drowned and overwhelmed by old casks. Glen Grant is, amongst other few single malts, one of those which manages to exert its personality over an old cask over time, which makes really old bottlings well worth looking into. And you know, even now, you don't have to go to auction to the secondary bottle market to buy really, really old Glen Grants. You can actually buy first-hand shop-bought bottlings, and I'm sure your local liquorist could buy get one in for you if you really wanted it, that date back to being distilled in the 1930s. 1930s. I suspect, malt mates, just a guess, just a hunch, that the first 100-year-old single malt to appear in the market will be a Glen Grant. Just sharing, just a hunch. I'm Ralphie. Thank you for watching this vlog. I hope you found it informative, illustrative, and illuminating. I hope with practice, patience, and perseverance, you will persist in perfecting your malt nose for many more malt moments. And there you have it. Cheers. Lovely. Oh, it's getting a bit more sour now. Gooseberry sour.